This is a. I'm really excited to be able to introduce you guys because I've watched the series and it's fantastic. And one of the things it really does very well is it gives an idea for folks in the emergency side to understand kind of how broad neurosurgery is. For most of our providers, and this is really in the field, but also even in most EDs, they think of neurosurgeons as kind of like, oh, just a brain surgeon. And they don't realize how specialized it is and how complex it can get, whether it's vascular to skull base, to cancer, to spine, to implanted devices. There's like a really complicated breadth of neurosurgery that most of us don't really know about. The introduction is, today we're going to hear from Dr. Langer and Dr. Boockvar. Dr. Langer is the chair of neurosurgery at Lenox Hill, vice president of neurosurgery for Western Region of Northwell. He's a professor at Zucker. Dr. Boockvar is vice chair of the Department of Neurosurgery and the director of brain tumor and pituitary neuroendocrine centers. He's also they're both very active researchers and give a lot back to the medical science community regarding neurosurgery. The thing that I think that I'm hoping that we'll all learn about is really that it's not just any neurosurgeon isn't any neurosurgeon, that there's a lot of breadth here. And especially when you get to complicated neurosurgery, what they've built at Lenox Hill is really incredible and really state of the art. And not just the skills of the individual surgeons, but the skills of the team. I think that one similarity across is that we all recognize how important teamwork is. Now for us, that might be two paramedics working a patient on the side of the road or in their apartment. And for them, it's the team that they have in the OR. And they've built such a solid team. And I think you, for those of you who watched the series, you've experienced that. This is such a thrill to be able to have us learn from them and hear about what they've built. So guys, thank you so much.
Before you start that, Rebecca, I just want to comment a couple of things that were said. Teamwork's everything. We're remarkably aware of that. John is like my best friend and colleague and confidant. And we have a situation here that we started from zero. So we didn't have some of the legacy that many of our competitors, unfortunately, to deal with. We're designed to care for one another and our patients. You guys have a lot of choices where to take patients. I can tell you today, we broke seven years ago, we had no department. When I first moved to Lenox, the space I was supposed to go in was taken away because no one really wanted me to go here. John came a year later in 2014. And in 7 years, now we're in newest News and World Report for the first time, we broke the top 50 in 7 years. If you look at the other departments that are on that list, every single one of them has been around at least 50 years to 100 years. Universities, Ivy League medical schools. And it's not because we're so great, it's because we just do the right thing. Then I just heard tonight that Becker's put the top spine outcomes in New York City, and it was us and HSS. And it's not because we're so terrific. There are a lot of good surgeons in New York. It's not about the surgery in the OR. It's about the team outside the OR. It's about our nurses. For that matter, it's about our EMS. Look, there are a lot of great surgeons. When I got to Lenox alone, I learned this, unfortunately, the hard way. I thought I was the greatest surgeon on earth. And I do feel like I'm talented. But I saw things happening that weren't in my control. And before the OR, the film's missing, the wrong case, the OR staff not being prepared for what we were doing. The ICU care suspect, the discharge incorrect, and what we by attacking that from the beginning and starting from zero, we were able to eliminate a lot of that friction. We're as good as anybody with our hands, but we're better than everybody with our hearts and our team because we have people around us that buy into this, and our attendings are all like-minded with this, and that's why we're different. It doesn't mean there aren't great other institutions that take nothing away from the institutions, but there are no better people. And we've been able to do this because of starting from zero and having, the ability to track people like John and Fat Matter Griffin, Baum and Spine. That's why we're in the top 15 US News Report. That's why we're in the top outcomes in spine and cost in spine. And we're very grateful for this opportunity. I think Netflix reflected that. So go ahead.
So human being here, everybody, eyes closed, deep breath, a lot of craziness today, obviously. Let's focus on the work. Let's do a good job for this guy.
Lenox Hill was a sleepy little Upper East Side hospital competing with some of the greatest health institutions in the world.
You cannot choose what comes at you here. It's like the front line.
We deal with death and dying. I don't even dare to imagine what I'm going to encounter on any given day.
So I don't have cancer.
Well, that's what I want to talk to you a little bit about.
I think there's such a thing as a calling.
Yes, that's good.
This is the space I'm supposed to be in.
There's just so much emotional energy that goes into doing this. The pressure really is intense sometimes. It weighs on you.
Are you awake?
Open your eyes, sweetie.
Everything we do here is for the patient. Humanity, empathy, that has to drive the decision making.
That's the way to do it.
It's a collage of people that come in.
You're doing so good.
We take whoever, whatever. You have to come here with a really open mind of how these people are feeling.
I want to work with populations medicine has traditionally neglected.
Get angry. Yes, you can. Listen to me. You can.
Terry.
I don't care if I gotta get every damn cell.
It's the humanity of your own patient that matters. This is a human being in front of us. You cannot fuck it up. You just can't.
Gentlemen, ladies, ready to roll? Everything you do,
be stronger. You're about to see what greatness is all about. What the fuck?
Putting my special mask on.
So I just wanted to sort of introduce a little bit about what we're doing here at Lenox Hill, and David obviously will follow. I didn't want to inundate us with just cases, but like David said, I'm just going to echo his sentiment. We're all about state-of-the-art treatment and future directions. This got cut off here. But on the bottom here, I think it's very important to recognize that we're not just a hospital, we're a large academic research institution, and of course we're tied to a now massive medical school enterprise that includes medical student education and nursing education and just about every level of education that occurs in healthcare. And we run in neurosurgery 138 clinical trials. Just to put that in comparison, that's more than most other neurosurgery departments in the city combined. So we're running clinical trials in stroke, in glioblastoma, in spine, and that's really as big a part of our mission as anything else. And none of us are incentivized financially to run these clinical trials. And my only financial disclosure is that David and I spun off a company last summer called Enertroy Bio, for which we currently get no royalty or income from it, but it is a way for us to leverage our expertise in breaking down the blood-brain barrier and helping patients and providers overcome the blood-brain barrier and deliver drugs to the human brain. The acknowledgement list keeps growing. Obviously, this spans, David and I both trained at Penn, but obviously, like David mentioned, it's our teamwork that makes our dream work when it comes to what we're doing. And these are just a handful of the personalities that help really motivate us. Obviously, we started, like David said, with what we call the core four of us, myself, David, and Rafa Ortiz and Mitch Levine. Mitch does spine, Rafa does stroke and endovascular treatments. David obviously does everything. We were able to recruit superstar Jason Ellis from Columbia through Emory's fellowship and just built, I think, David, we're at 12 or 14 faculty now. So we've expanded our presence, obviously, in the Western sector, but now we get international patients that seek out Lenox Hill Neurosurgery. Down here in the bottom left is one of our conferences. We have 5 or 6 weekly conferences. We call them boards, tumor board, vascular board, epilepsy, spine. all really multidisciplinary groups of individuals. There is not one case that doesn't get multiple set of eyes because more eyes are better, more eyes are unbiased. And we think outside the box. Here in the middle of the panel is David and myself thinking about ways to reduce our stress, get into what we call the flow channel, and maximize ideas of how do we reduce boredom and anxiety. Up here in the top is some of our clinical trials office. These are some people I brought over from Cornell about 6 years ago. Cherise Fralin is essentially one of the world's best nurse practitioners in neuro-oncology research, Tamika Wong, Shamik Chakraborty, Mona Lee, others. And as David said, it's our team in the OR that really makes it special. We're not too serious. We just like to get the job done and get it done in a way that's safe for our patients with exceptional outcomes. Just to let you know, we're the only neurosurgery department in the city to earn Health Grades Cranial Neurosurgery Excellence Award in 2018 and 19, with the lowest morbidity and mortality. So we're quite proud of our outcomes. Again, this is our basic science lab at Feinstein Institute for Medical Research, which is based on Long Island. All the basic science research that goes on by these brilliant scientists is really put to the bedside through our nurse practitioners in the bottom right and our amazing PAs in our department. So it really is a multidisciplinary enterprise. I just wanted to show one case, which I really think this is a credit to EMS, and it's a very simple case. This happened last year. This was a son of a Lenox Hill nurse, and it really exemplifies what makes your job so important and really makes our relationship so important. At the end of the day, you guys saved lives. You saved this gentleman's life. By the time he'd gone to me, you would work so quickly and prudently that you would save the life of an employee at Lenox. And for that, frankly, I get the credit for it. And if there's a way for me to even give over that credit to you guys in the EMS group, this is really where it started. So he presented, he's a 36-year-old male who had presented with obtundation. He was found by his wife to be quite lethargic and mental status had changed. He had had a shunt placed as a child. I think he was 8 years old. And the teaching point here is obviously he was lethargic and he had Paranaut syndrome. And I'm going to talk a little bit about Paranaut syndrome is because I think as in EMS, it's one of the most important neurosurgical emergencies. When he got to us, he had gotten a CAT scan of the head, which you see here in the bottom left, which shows dilatation of the ventricles in the human brain. Remember, the human brain has four chambers like the heart does. We call them ventricles. There are two lateral ventricles that mirror each other. They drain into the third ventricle. And what is not shown here is the fourth ventricle. So like there are two atria and ventricles in the human heart, we have four ventricles in the human brain, essentially. And if they clog with fluid, that patient can die, and time matters. This, you can see here in the bottom right, is a shunt catheter that was probably 20 years old. And it actually had migrated. As the child grows, it can pull on the shunt catheter and basically had pulled the shunt out of the ventricle. This patient, if left unattended or incorrectly diagnosed or delayed in any meaningful way by EMS, dies in his bedroom. This is Paranaut syndrome. We don't see these hydrocephalic kids anymore unless you're at Kings County Hospital in Brooklyn, where I did medical school training. We saw kids like this all the time. This is a hydrocephalic child with Paranaut syndrome. This is conjugate down gaze in the primary position. And we call this the setting sun sign. And this is an extremely important sign, most commonly in patients with failed shunts or acute hydrocephalus. Now, in a neonate or an infant, we can take a needle and actually stick it through the soft portions of the skull. And we call that a fontanelle tap. But in the adult that you guys transferred into me so quickly, in the emergency room, in the trauma bay, we recognized that this patient needed to go urgently upstairs and get what we call a proximal shunt revision, which we did within essentially an hour of this patient's admission. So, you know, time matters. Your speed and your smarts really matter. I think your choice of hospitals matter. You need to know that you're landing in a destination of someone who is going to assess that patient. I was called emergently to the trauma bay, and we got this patient. We together saved this patient's life. And it's just one patient in a host of patients that you guys bring in on a daily basis, and we couldn't be more grateful for how quickly you guys act and the expertise that you do. Obviously, this is a trying time for all of us. I love this quote from Camus. I have no idea what's awaiting me or what will happen when this all ends. For the moment, I know this, there are sick people and they need curing. Obviously, in neurosurgery, this pre-COVID, we were dealing with death and dying in glioblastoma and stroke, in aneurysm rupture, and obviously hydrocephalus, and we deal with very difficult issues. I can tell you that during COVID was one of the most incredible experiences for our department, which David touched on. We were one of the, if not, I think, David, we were the first department at Lenox to shut down and repivot. We became the clinical trials office and center for COVID-19 in the Western sector. We enrolled 100 patients in clinical trials for COVID. That may not sound like a lot, but that usually takes 5 years to do in neurosurgery. And obviously there was risk going in, consenting patients and their families knowing that they were high risk. So this has been incredibly productive and informative and really team building experience for all of us. And obviously we're just grateful for our colleagues in EMS for helping us do all this. So with that, I'll stop sharing and take some questions. Rebecca, did that come across okay? It's hard for me to.
Yeah, no, that was great. Thank you. To everyone, please submit your questions to the chat. Everyone is muted, but we can see the chat and would love to answer any questions that you have.
Yeah. Dr. Boockvar, that was great. I just wanted to point your attention to the Q&A. Somebody also submitted a question in there that says, what were your reasons for entering the medical field? If you want to start with that.
I think that's a great question, and I have an identical twin brother. So the question is equally, what made him not enter the medical field? I think that each one of us has, as far as I can remember, I had dreamed of entering the medical field. My father was a community ophthalmologist, actually at Long Island Jewish, I think it's called Valley Stream now, or what was then Franklin General Hospital. I was always drawn to health and wellness and my father's impact that he was having at the community level. And from the youngest of age, I knew that I wanted to enter healthcare. And frankly, my brother knew that he didn't want to enter healthcare. So I just entered my college training and devoted myself to understanding neuroanatomy. It's what piqued my interest. I always say you're good at what you like and you like what you're good at. And all roads pointed me toward neurology, neurosurgery, or psychiatry because of my interest in the human brain.
Fantastic. A question is, what's the best and hardest part of your job?
I think the hardest part of our job is balance, in work-life balance. I think that in addition to obviously the psychological impact of what we deal with on a day-to-day basis is how do we, I'll give an example. David and I did a very, very large brain tumor today in a woman who's 60. And I have a busy schedule this evening and I've been taking calls 5, 6, 7 o'clock. And I know my patient had a post-operative seizure. and I know my son needs to be up in upstate New York tomorrow. And these are things that we have to balance, and it's literally a juggling game. It's how do you maintain, obviously, safe patient care without ignoring the rest of your existence. And I think it takes confidence, it takes understanding, it takes partnership. I will tell you that the best thing I ever did, and as David mentioned in the first episode of Netflix, was to leave Cornell, not because I was unhappy. I was actually very happy at Cornell. It was productive for me. But coming to an institution, it's as if you've ever played a sport or been on a team or been a musician and know that there's a partner in the band that you can rely on to riff when your guitar goes down, or to pick up the ball or get the hot hand when your shooting goes cold. I tell you, that's the most important thing that's happened to me is working with David. I know he's at the hospital now, and if anything goes wrong, I don't have to get out of my seat because he'll take care of it for me, and vice versa. So those are the things that we try to teach our residents. So make sure you have a brother or sister in the room for every case, and make sure that you achieve that work-life balance.
That's fantastic. Thank you for sharing that. There are some good questions around changes to neurological and neurosurgical care. One, do you see it getting less invasive in the future? And then also just any changes, from an EMS and emergent perspective as well.
Well, the way I look at it is I look at my iPhone. And my wife will yell at me because I tend to upgrade my iPhone as soon as I can. And the rationale, it's the reason why I used to own my cars and now I lease them, is because I really believe the technology changes are significant enough to warrant upgrading. The automation in my Chevy Silverado right now is better than it was 3 years ago. And my iPhone navigation systems are better than they were 6 months ago. And actually our technology in surgery, the surgery that we did today, we took out a meningioma in a 63-year-old woman that was very, very large, about the size of a mango. And that would have taken me 12 hours in my residency. And it took us about 4.5 hours today. And the reason for that is our technology is better. And we have better imaging, we have better navigation tools, so I can point to anywhere in the human brain and know exactly where I am in three dimension. And that's extremely valuable. It makes it safer. It's essentially having a third eye behind the tumor so I can see where the blood vessels are. And I think you're probably seeing similar changes in EMS where the technology on the scenes are better, safer, intubation is safer, easier, techniques for administration of drugs, your navigation tools are better. So in general, your time to treat should be shortened, and that's gonna be important when it comes to stroke. We're using a lot of artificial intelligence techniques now, which we didn't use 5 years ago. We had a presentation today in our office using robotic techniques for spinal surgery. They bring an arm in and they place it on the patient, and basically the rest is up to the robot. So these are just really exciting times. I think the innovation, like we're seeing across the board in our handheld devices and our motor vehicles, is really transcending into healthcare as well.
Fantastic. First of all, thank you for all the great questions coming in. They're pouring in now.
Yeah, I can handle them if you'd like.
A few questions. Around potential health disparities. You did mention in the presentation, Kings County Hospital did still have, those cases of hydrocephalus. Could you talk a little bit about that and why that might be the case?
Yeah, and I think it touches on extremely important healthcare disparities that we're seeing in all of healthcare. We see, sexism, racism, healthcare disparities throughout healthcare, and we are actively and aggressively trying to combat those issues. In a place like Kings County in Brooklyn, where you have a lot of people coming in from outside the country, particularly in places like from Africa, from the Caribbean, from Haiti, we see a lot of undertreated or poorly treated hydrocephalus cases, particularly in young children. And so we see a host of illnesses, particularly from areas like Haiti and the Caribbean, that are not seeing, getting the correct treatment. And those healthcare disparities have to be addressed. They are being addressed. Our department is, I think it's become and has always been a driving force in how we approach all of our healthcare delivery, regardless of your sex, race, or ability to pay.
Thank you for sharing that. Any advice to paramedics when practically treating neuro emergencies?
My advice is, we're teammates, and if you are ever in a situation where we can be helpful, don't ever hesitate to ask for our cell phones, our contact. Obviously, while you're alone in the field, trust your gut, get help, and have a teammate with you. That's how we behave in our operating room. We treat the operating room like the cockpit of a plane, and there are always two pilots flying our plane. And so in my opinion, that's the best way to make sure you don't do anything wrong. And obviously wrong these days includes anything that can be offensive. And so we just act in a way that two people are flying the plane at all times.
Fantastic. There's also a similar question. I think you just addressed it, but are you ever in a situation where you don't know exactly what to do? And I think, again, you just talked about some of the teamwork and collaboration. I'm sure that's an important part of it.
Yeah, and I think I put up that picture of our tumor board because we can, and David touched on this, you can believe you're the best surgeon or the smartest, or you graduated first in your medical school class, and that may be true, but none of our cases are binary. There's a gray zone that requires intuition, it requires intelligence, emotional intelligence, IQ as well. And so having a partnership, and my relationship with David is, if I have an issue, I can walk in his office and without rebuke, know that he's giving me his honest, independent opinion. And there's no better way to go when it comes to the high, pressure cooker situations that EMS and neurosurgeons are under. And look, like I presented with that one case, that's one life saved. And that's a mother that has her son, that's a wife that has her husband, and that's children that has their father. And that's because we did that together. And there are multiple points along the route where that patient dies and becomes a statistic. So, I take that very, very seriously, and we measure every single case as the utmost importance.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Dr. Boockvar. This is great. And there definitely are more questions coming through, but Dr. Langer, do you want to chime in? And
Could I give a closing statement?
Yeah, of course.
I just want to give a shout out to Tim and Amy Hardig from episode 5 who've joined us. I think also Megan. Thank you guys for joining us from Detroit, and welcome to this CME.
Should I give my talk now? First of all, I want to thank, while I was watching the questions, I changed my talk. That's why I wasn't on the screen. Because You know, I think it's important we show cases. Look, we do great stuff here. I was going to show you a stroke and a bypass and vascular. And then I saw a question about COVID, and I think that's what's sort of on everybody's mind. But what's on John and I's minds are the importance of the whole group. You know, we recognize, and look, we know that we get a lot of attention. You know, Netflix blew that up too, but we're pretty normal. We make fun of each other. We cry alone, but we laugh together. You know, we suffer with our bad outcomes, and we know that we try our best. But it starts with you guys, first man in. I actually had a experience last summer where I was on the beach, where it's actually in the Netflix show, where I saw a guy basically become paraplegic in the water, and I just was sort of stabilized his neck until the paramedics got there. And it was one of the first times I've actually been there and saw what you do, like, in real life. Then I ended up operating on him, which was even more dramatic. But, you know, I saw in real life, you know, we don't see that very often. And to have experienced that personally and take care of the patient and see him his good outcome, we're lucky we get to see, to experience the kind of beginning and end, but not the true beginning. And that's what you guys get to see all the time. And I think that's why team's so important. I'm going to show a couple of slides about innovation, which I think we're very focused on here at Lenox, as well as teamwork. And there, I have a couple of metaphors for this stuff. And I think these both really are representative and are indicative of what we're doing here. And then I'll talk a little about COVID, because I think that's what's sort of on people's minds. So let me talk about the Fosbury flop. And John heard this earlier. And I like this metaphor a lot. So this is a guy named Dick Fosbury, who was a high jumper in the 1968 Olympics. And he wasn't a particularly great athlete, actually. He was tall, but he basically won the gold medal in Mexico City with that jump. And I'm not sure if you're aware, that looks pretty normal to us. It's actually really low. It's only 6 feet plus. But up until the 68 Olympics, people didn't jump that way. They used to jump in the forward. They used to do the scissor kick and jump over the bar. But Fosbury came with this idea of landing on his back and on his head, and he revolutionized the high jump. Well, the reason why I thought, reading about this, I thought, well, he must have just come up with this great idea about that this would be a better way. In fact, the way it really works is the center of gravity, he made it over his chest rather than his abdomen, and that's why he can jump over 6 feet. The truth is, he came up with this because of another issue. About in the early 60s and the 50s, these high jumpers were twisting their ankles and twisting their knees and tearing ligaments in the knees and getting fractures, jumping forward over it, landing on their feet, because the pit was made of sand, which isn't soft. In order to protect the athletes, the high jump authorities decided, you know what, we got to save the athletes, we got to make a soft landing. And people continue to jump in the usual way, side scissor and land on their feet. Well, Fosbury realized once you change the landing pad, you can change the way you jump. Once you change the environment, it's chaos. He was the first one to realize that he didn't have to land on his feet anymore. He could land on his back and his head and be safe. And I think that this is a metaphor for our department. I think we realize that if we take care of people, we take care of one another, we take the money out of it, we kind of focus on good outcome, good things happen. And it's a metaphor for innovation. You know, the COVID is an example of that too. The fact that we're having this Zoom conference and able to educate you and meet you this way, this wouldn't have happened without COVID. I think maybe that's why it's important to talk about COVID from a scientific and a medical and a sort of historic perspective. Because this is going to change us. It's changed me personally, and I'll go into why. It's changed the way we deal with our everyday. And it's in many things made Lenox Hill Hospital even closer. And it's sort of our Fosbury flop. It's our chaos. It's our change that's driving us to make changes. And this little butterfly over here is a representative of that. We're here to change. We're going to emerge from this better than we when it went in. And that's what our butterfly project is. You know, I was a rower in college. And the other thing that we really focus on is the idea of, we don't really care what everybody else is doing. We're going to focus on innovation. We're going to make ourselves the best we can be. And that's all you can do. Because if you keep your head in the boat and you focus on your own work and making yourself the best, you'll end up winning no matter what. Even if somebody may be higher or better than you, who cares? Watching your competition doesn't help you get better. In fact, it can only slow you down. This is a video, if you watch these guys, of the eight final in Brazil, in Rio de Janeiro in the last in the 1998 Olympics. Not one of these guys takes their eyes off the boat. I'm not going to even show you who wins. It doesn't matter. They're just putting their work in. They're pulling as hard as they can. They're maintaining a straight course, and they're just getting to the finish line. We don't really have a finish line in neurosurgery. That's the beauty of us. We can just keep doing this, and we love what we do. And the COVID, what COVID taught us is the benefits of being under stress and duress. And so I'm going to talk a little bit about the disease and about the illness, and John's welcome to chime in because John is a expert on this as well. And then I'll talk a little about our response and just a final, you know, idea about, you know, where we are now. So the virus, we know, came from China. Whether it come this wholesale seafood market or not, no one really knows. I don't know if we'll ever know. It might have come from this virology lab. It's a coronavirus. There are seven known coronaviruses that infect humans. There's a very, very high similarity between COVID-19 and one of the bat coronaviruses. Bats turn out to be an amazing repository of viral infections because they're ubiquitous all over the world. As we have more animals that we basically use for domestication, as human population has grown, there are more cows and horses and pigs, and bats feed on these domestic animals. The bats tend to be in barns and hidden in all these places. We'll never eradicate bats, it's impossible. So we'll never eradicate viruses. And in fact, this won't be the last time that a new virus comes out. And that's the lesson. We have to be prepared better for the next time from an EMS perspective, from medical perspective, from a human perspective, and from just a general health perspective. I'm sure what you guys saw and what you put yourselves through must have been remarkable. And you probably can give a similar talk from your own perspective, what we're going to show you today. You know, I love this slide. The truth is that people didn't get infected from eating an uncooked bat. But the truth is that one person can change the world. Look at Elon Musk. You know, we can be innovative. We can do things differently. We can generate teams of people around us. And we can really do things differently and make a difference. And whether it's a negative, like getting infected from a bat coronavirus, or whether it's a positive by creating SpaceX or Tesla, you know, you can do creative things with groups of great groups of people. And that's our ethic. And that's our group's ethic. You know, the virus itself looks kind of like this. It's basically a capsid protein, which is the green. These little red things are the actually binding proteins that bind the cell. It's actually the ACE receptor on the, primarily in the pulmonary endothelium, the angiotensin converting enzyme receptor. It's a single strand of RNA all wrapped up inside that capsid. And it presents with classic symptoms and signs. In fact, early on, when we didn't have the testing, if you had a chest x-ray, a cough, and a fever, you had COVID. And that was just, it was really a clinical diagnosis. You know, when I went to medical school, my intensive care unit professor used to tell me that there are four kinds of patients in ICU: not sick, sick, very sick, and too sick. And from an EMS perspective, this makes sense too. If you pick up a drunk in the street and you intubate that guy because you don't know what's going on, and you bring him to the ER, and by the next morning he's in the ICU extubated and like coming off a hangover, that guy's gonna go home and he's not sick. If he's sick, if someone's sick, it means they have a real problem. But basically, if you leave them alone and don't expose them to, you know, some hospital acquired infection or some morbidity, they do well no matter what you do to them. The goal from a physician perspective, or certainly from your perspective as an EMS, is to find who's very sick or too sick. A too sick patient is a patient who's dead in the street or is so sick that you can't do anything. We've seen all those people. The very sick patient is who we can impact. And as an EMS person, that's the person we need to focus on. Get them to the right place. Get them the team that can take care of them that you trust, because those patients are salvageable and they need good care to be able to get to that point, to be able to go home in one piece. Those people we're focused on. And in fact, during COVID, we were worried that the too sick patients were going to overwhelm our system, take up all the ventilators, take up all the ICU beds. And Lenox did an incredible job in Northwell, for that matter, of spreading out of a volume load in the system. So we were able to take care of the very sick patient. I think if it does come back, which I actually have, I don't know if it's going to come back for a variety of reasons. If it does, hopefully patients won't come in too sick. Part of the problem is they were arriving and they were afraid of the hospitals. And that made it hard for you guys too, because you, I'm sure you encountered just people who are essentially in respiratory failure, intubating in the street, intubating in the ER. That was terrible. But ultimately, presenting with mild symptoms is what was important. We want to get those people before they get sick. After the hydrochloroquine and azithromycin thing kind of resolved, we realized that early steroids and antivirals worked, and early treatment and blocking the cytotoxic storm was key. In this picture, we see myself poorly covered with PPE. In the foreground is one of our pulmonologists with his fellow, one of our intensivists, anesthesiologists, the pharmacist, and the medical intern. We put these incredible teams together. We created ICU staff, clinical trials teams, which I'll show you later. And neurosurgery, we basically realized, you know, we're turning ourselves off, but we're gonna go try to make a difference and make an impact in this terrible, terrible wave of patients that we were dealing with. Just to give you a quick update on oxygenation ventilation, remember, carbon dioxide is ventilation, oxygenation is oxygenation. The way you lower CO2, increase tidal volume, breathe more or bigger breaths, that lowers your CO2. If you want to increase the amount of oxygen in somebody's body, you got to give them more oxygen or give them PEEP, positive pressure. In fact, what happened during COVID on these PDEF ratios, this is a measure of the AA gradients that people experience. And people with a PDEF ratio of 150 or lower are thought to be essentially going to die. But we routinely saw in the ICU people with poor PDEF ratios, people with pulmonary pressure, arterial pressures over their inspiratory oxygen pressures that were really, really bad. But COVID does that, and we were able to salvage a number of these patients. And the way we did that was basically by identifying who truly was in the cytotoxic storm. A lot of that bad oxygenation was from fluid in the lungs and was basically from this massive cytotoxic storm. And the CRP, the C-reactive protein, was the first indicator of that. So if a CRP starts to go up in the setting of shortness of breath, blast them with steroids, Lasix, drying them out, that seemed to be very, very effective. These other serum indices were also effective. D-dimer, turns out, was reflective of your hypercoagulable state. So if your D-dimer went too high, we would anticoagulate people. Over 3,000 D-dimer, we were heparinizing them, we're giving them Lovenox. If people's procalcitonin went up, that was a sign of an infection. Very often, people came so late to the hospital, they had high CRP and procalcitonin, and they had consolidation of their lungs, and we realized that that would need an antibiotics, not steroids, because those people had pneumonia. We need to educate people to come. When you get short of breath and a fever, get to the hospital. Don't be afraid. Treat early. That was key. We had to prevent respiratory failure. Early intervention and oxygen worked, and we realized we really have to avoid mechanical ventilation. This is a typical X-ray of a COVID patient. In fact, I took this picture when I was at the Javits Center. On the right lung, which is the left side of your screen, is a typical ground glass appearance of COVID. On the left is a more normal appearing clear lung. The bases at the base and the left base was bad, but that's sort of the difference between a clear lung and a COVID lung. It looks almost like a spider web. And ultimately, this is severe damage to the lung. It caused end organ inflammation and damage. In fact, it causes damage to the pulmonary vasculature, the kidneys, the lung, the liver, the CNS, the brain, the spinal cord, and also results in massive immunological failure. Initially, because patients were coming to us so sick, and I'm sure you saw this, 50% of the admitted patients required the ICU, and 80% of those people required mechanical ventilation. Ultimately, though, what it came down to is, as neurosurgeons, what the hell were we gonna do? Ultimately, we saw this stuff. We saw encephalopathy, people were confused, unconscious. We saw instances of demyelinating disease, episodes of seizures. The trouble is there wasn't much we could do about it because ultimately we were preserving PPE. We didn't want to expose people to things. It was very just hard to just get a scan. And so ultimately, given that there were really lack of therapeutics for these things, we kind of pulled back and said, hey, if you have a seizure, treat the seizure. If it looks like you had a stroke, nothing we can really do. And that was incredibly uncomfortable. As the volume started to drop, we were able to image people more effectively and learn more about COVID. But the CNS dysfunction often was part of multi-system organ failure. We saw a significant amount of pulmonary failure, kidney failure. In fact, this JAMA article was from one of the original groups of the population that was infected in Lombardy in Italy. And you start to see what this looked like. The majority of the patients were in their 60s. Their PDF ratios were really high, like basically around 130. These patients were super sick, huge AE gradients, high inspiratory oxygen required, over 60% oxygen with PEEPs around 13 to 14. So these are super sick patients. So when you pick them up, you've got to get them ventilated. I would argue even give them steroids. You got to get them oxygenated and really take care of their airway first, and then make sure we identify these at-risk patients. This is sort of to show you what happened at Lenox. There was one question like, what did Lenox do? So on March 20th, Lenox had only 41 patients. Early in March, and John really was John scared the shit out of me. He was like, you know, Chicken Little. I thought he's like, oh my God, this is gonna be terrible. He was right, actually. And he said, we gotta shut this down. We gotta turn everything off. And I was like, you know, trying to balance all these different issues. And that came out in the COVID episode. But ultimately, he was right. And we turned off our elective volume kind of second week of March. Lenox normally holds about 400 patients. By March 20th, we only had 294, 19 of which were COVID, 31 of which were under investigation or being tested. By the next day, we had 51 patients, went from 41 to 51 in one day. These are the major floors in Lenox where we were housing patients, 8 East, 8 EA, was our neuro ICU, which was taken from us. 7 East was the MICU. We started these COVID units, we were building units along the way. Look at the ED, had 6 patients under investigation. And I also want to point to 7 East, which was the MICU. Out of the 12 COVID patients in there, 10 were intubated. Those little quadrangles were intubated patients. By the 23rd, now we have 66 patients. 8 East is full of COVID. 7 East, we're starting to fill up Lockman. The house census is still under 300, but by the 28th, a week later, now we have 143 COVID patients in the hospital. We had to change these graphs to just the ICUs. At this point, 5 East, which was CCU, 8 East was the neuro ICU, 7 East was the MICU. We started building new ICU beds to handle this massive surge. Now we're starting to see this bump with 329 overall patients, 143 of which were COVID. By the 11th of April, it looked like this. This is about our peak. Over 300 COVID patients at Lenox. Look, these were all ICUs. We had to scale this up. This is a massive stressor. And our good outcomes, we had 408 patients literally 3 weeks later. Essentially, 3/4 of the hospital was COVID. Well, by, you know, when it started to come down by mid-April, and I'm happy to tell you that today, there are less than 1 patient that has COVID at Lenox. Our house census gradually come up. We ended up taking care of 1,300 COVID patients with a 18% mortality. We were way below the national average, the New York average, and the world average. And why is that? Because of teams. Lenox is a remarkable place. We get along. We open our hearts to our patients, as was reflected at Netflix, which is real. And we innovate, and we don't attack people. Our egos are checked at the door. If you look at New York City, look at the excess deaths in New York City in April. Compared to September 11th, this was a joke. You know, this was a massive disruption. And I'm a Manhattanite, I live in Manhattan. Walking home every night and seeing the disruption of the city was one of the most emotional things I've ever been through. And it continues this day. And I fear for my kids and my family, just like you do. But I think there's hope. You know, if we can keep the viral spread down, and this what's called R naught, which is the ratio of one person to how many people one person infects. We just have to keep this R naught down under 1. As long as one person can only infect less than one person, we'll keep this outbreak from happening again. As soon as one person infects more than one person, we can either have an outbreak. You know, John and I both are really fans of a guy named Scott Gottlieb, who's right of center. He's a fellow at the American Enterprise Institute. And he really wrote this kind of treatise on the road to recovery that the administration theoretically adopted about how we were gonna emerge from COVID. We're still very much in phase 2. You know, phase 3, when we can actually go back to Broadway and life we had before, it's going to require a vaccine or at least proven therapeutics. and we, along with robust surveillance, I'm not sure that the United States will ever get to the point where we're actually doing robust surveillance with tracing and quarantining well. But the vaccine is closer than we think. In fact, I know the scientist that developed the virus, the vaccine for the virus, and this is going to work. I'm very, very optimistic about the vaccine. But beyond the vaccine, we have to change the way we think. You know, there was a day where we were running out of ventilators, and I was trying to get my wife, who's an anesthesiologist, said, call the plastic surgeons. There are tons of ventilators around Lenox because there are tons of plastic surgery practices. So I called our chair of plastic surgery, and I'm like, Charlie, let's get, so we were arranging this to happen, and I had like 40 ventilators to bring to Lenox on a Friday, but our loading dock isn't open on the weekend, so it had to wait till Monday. And over the weekend, the mayor basically came on and said, we're basically taking the ventilators. And our chief medical officer, I called, I said, Dan, this is terrible. We're gonna lose these things to the mayor, to the governor. You know, we got to get these Lenox. He said something will resonate with me to this day. It's not about the ventilator coming to Lenox. If we don't get one, then someone else in need will get one. It's not like they're just gonna throw them out the window. And what changed during COVID is this kind of establishment of one for all and all for one. We were all in this together. It was a unique time. 9/11 was just 0.01% of this. I realized that, yes, if Lenox didn't get the ventilator, that was okay. Because we had this incredible ethic that we just are here to do good and help patients. And John, you know, not only is my closest friend, but he's just an incredible human being. And the people he surrounds himself with and the effort he makes to constantly do the right thing and to create teams of people and create respect and trust. And what he basically stood up himself and his team, not just glioblastoma trials anymore, but this guy ran COVID trials on a dime. And he basically took these people and they worked their asses off. They were here on weekends at nights, exposing themselves and always doing the right thing. And they had an enormous impact on our environment here at Lenox Hill. And watching him and seeing what he did was so motivating for me. And we feed off one another. We feed off that ethic between ourselves. And that's the greatest thing, having a guy that's not only your closest friend, but is better than me at certain things. And it makes me better. And that's what makes our department better. And that's why we're gonna be better. We're gonna build back better. That's what our butterfly project is. We have to make ourselves better, whether it's Zoom meetings or Microsoft Teams, or encouraging you to give us the opportunity to take care of your patients. Smarter medicine, smarter tech. We have a mobile app here in our department that allows us to send patients videos, audio files, texts. Screw the EMR. We're going to make content that really matters to people and makes them smarter about their problem, and a better educated consumer and a better customer. This guy, his name is Zach Iskall. He's running for mayor. He's about to announce it. He worked for the governor at Jacob Javits Center. He was a Marine. And he told me when I was over there, he said, you know, Dave, I've been in Fallujah. I've been in Iraq. I've killed Iraqis. I've killed the enemy. But being here fighting the COVID enemy and saving lives was the greatest experience of my life. That's the beauty of being a healthcare worker. We do remarkable things, but we don't realize it sometimes. We gotta let people in. You know, when they came to John and I about the Netflix show, we could not take this on because we know we're legit. And we knew if we let them in, they'd see us for who we really are. Because what we do every day as neurosurgeons, or for that matter, an EMS worker, a nurse, a respiratory tech, we do remarkable things for people every day. And Zach saw that, and now he's running for mayor. And he's motivated to do good, because that's the kind of guy he is. But he saw that helping people ultimately is the most important thing that you can do for one another. You know, this op-ed piece came out right in the midst of this on April 15th. And the op-ed piece was about how we coddle people and we give people, there's great elevation in our colleges and our schools. But, and I was kind of like turned off by it when I read it. But it went on to say how healthcare and medicine, people who go into medicine, are testing. When you're testing in science, you can't make it up. That basically what you score in science, like playing golf, you can't, you hit a number of shots. You can't write an essay and say, oh, that's an A. You is what it is. I tell guys, Mike, and I know John feels the same way, we train our residents. It's either yes or no. And I'm sure it's like that as an EMS worker too. There's no wiggle room. And we train hard. We go through hardship. We deal with difficult things and difficult problems and problems we can't solve. And what Brooks went on to say, it's about tenacity and character. He said he's reminded of the maxim, excellence is not an action, it's a habit. Tenacity is not a spontaneous flowering of good character. It's doing what you were trained to do. It manifests not in those whose training spared them hardship, but in those whose training embraced hardship and taught their students to deal with it. And I think that our department did that. You know, we realized that we trained hard. We had something to offer. And when I went to Javits, actually, I went there originally to show my mobile app, because when I originally went to the ICU, I wanted to use it to communicate with patients and help them with their families who were at home. But when I got there, the last thing they needed was some Yahoo neurosurge with a mobile app. This place was coming apart at the seams. They didn't know what they're doing. The intensive care unit, which is right in front of you in the middle, was stood up in the Javits Center. And these guys are from Texas and Florida and Georgia. They were trained for battle. They were trained for trauma. They weren't trained in COVID. And luckily, I'd been at Lenox for a few weeks, and I kind of knew a few things. And when I went there at first, I got undressed in this military. And I got to tell you, I thought about stealing one of these jackets. They were the coolest thing there. I wish I had one. But you saw the ethic of the military and kind of like MacGyvering everything. And this woman here on the right, you know, I can speak for John too. And I say that we love doing big cases. John did this massive brain tumor today. You know, it's great to do these crazy things that require our skills and our hands. But the short time that I trained at Lenox, I learned how to manage the pulmonary physiology in COVID. And when this woman came in, she was intubated and she couldn't breathe. And managing her through it because of my experience at Lenox allowed me to extubate her. And this in many ways was one of the best things I'd ever been through as a physician. I mean, you can take all the bypasses and brain tumors, but you know what? Doing things like this was incredibly gratifying. And I think we all feel that way in our group. You know, every day outside the hospital, and you hear John and I outside.
Half of the social distancing. Respecting each other, that's not a good thing.
You know, John and I would come out every day and see that. But I think the thing we both realized is it wasn't the doctors. You know, it was you guys, the firemen, the nurses, the respiratory techs, you know, filling a role that, you know, and we had this, you know, 7 o'clock clap. I almost felt embarrassed by it. You know, watching the nurses enjoy their time and the respect that they had was really gratifying. Early on, we didn't know what's going on. We reached across the world to Wuhan. This is actually a Zoom call we had with a group of doctors from Wuhan to just get their insight into how they manage COVID patients. This is early April, but this is actually middle of March. You know, to see where we are as a country now, and it just this is just such a bad thing. That we have to care for one another. And that's what we do. I'm gonna finish with this, that this was, I think this really, whether you're a physician, a doctor, a nurse, or an EMS worker, that this really represents, I think, what we're about. This was I found this basically years ago, anthropologist Margaret Mead, who looked at fossils and, you know, Cro-Magnon man and Australopithecus, she was one of the early archaeologists, was asked by a student what she considered to be the first sign of civilization and culture. The student expected me to talk about fish hooks or clay pots or grinding stones, but no, Mead said the first sign of civilization in ancient culture was a femur that had been broken and then healed. Mead explained in the animal kingdom, if you break your leg, you die. You cannot run from danger, get to the river for a drink or hunt food. You're meat for prowling beasts. No animal survives a broken leg long enough for the bone to heal. A broken femur that's healed is proof that someone has taken time to stay with a person who's fell, has bound up the wound, has carried the person to safety, and has tended the person through recovery. Helping someone through difficulty is where civilization starts, said Mead. We are at our best when we serve others. That's what you guys do every day. That's what we do every day. But it's a continuum. And we need one another to in this day and age, you know, we're not prowling beasts. We're here to make a difference. And we're here to, you guys are the first people in. And we need you and you need us. And we're so, you know, appreciative of your taking the time to listen to us tonight. So thank you. And that's that.
Thank you, Dr. Langer. That was inspiring and motivating and amazing. I do want to be respectful of time. Maybe we'll do one or two questions and then we can end with some closing comments. Jenny. Let's see what's coming through.
Just what was your, Johnny, what was your motivation, no matter how tired you were emotionally or physically, to do what you do, Johnny?
You know, I think the good news about our job is it doesn't really matter how much you sleep or how tired you are. Your enthusiasm always is reflected in the minute you sort of start your day, your case, and that, to me, is really what motivates me. I don't require a lot of sleep, you know, the passion is, it's like what David said, in it's the humanity in all of us that drives us to do what we do. So I don't measure my days in sleep or anything like that. Every day that bell rings and we start our day, it's really just inspiration that motivates me.
One of the questions is, what is something you wish EMS did better, want EMS to do a better job when dealing with patients that have neuroemergencies? All I can say is this. One of our biggest problems is finding, getting back to you, feeding back to you. It must be very difficult when you pick a patient up and you see and you do everything you can and drop them off and not, it's hard for us to, we want to get back to you to let you know how patients did for better or worse. You know, you need to see the full circle. We get it. We're lucky enough. Our jobs, we see that. And John and I, we both will take a patient up to the ICU or whatever. You know, one option is if you could somehow, we know we can have our cell phones, Rebecca can arrange for that. If you drop a patient off with us, we can add you to Playback, which is our mobile app. We can add you to the patient care team. We could put messages in there or videos of what happened to the patient, which the patient sees. And that way you at least get the feeling that we do. Because when you care for patient only in one end, you don't get the other end. I think that's not fair. And that perhaps if EMS got the full circle and you see the impact that you had and close that circle, it would be, you know, I think really beneficial to everyone. So we can talk about that. I'm happy to look at ways that we can do that better. You know, actually, that's the next question. How can we close that circle? You know, ultimately, it's all a circle. It starts here. And then the patient goes home and they're back where they were. They're back in their home. And when you pick them up in their home or on the street or on the curb, you never see that come back to its original point. You deserve that. That's your hard work. That's what you deserve to see that. And so I think that, you know, I'll leave it up to Rebecca and your leadership, but we can create that pathway. So if you bring a patient to Lenox Hill, we will give you that feedback back, whether it's through a direct phone call or a video or a text. I think it's important that we do that. And we want to do that. We're excited about that opportunity. And I think that's something maybe we can grow out of this, and let's do that for sure. So, you know, Brian and John, Rebecca, let's just figure out a way, because I think that our greatest, let me tell you something, that no matter how great an operation is, it's when the patient walks in your office and gives you a hug and some cookies. That's when we do our job. There's nothing worse. I could take all the positives. One bad outcome, one complication ruins it all. So we need those moments to see our patients do well, to make up for the times when they don't. And you guys don't get that. You have to have that. And the more we can give that to you, I think that'll only make you happier and better at your job and make you a healer, not just a you know, not just at one end. So I think that's a something we could definitely do.
Absolutely. We will stay closely connected and figure out the details with EMS leadership of how we can make that a reality. I think playback is a great way to do that.
John, there's a question. Why do you think so many healthcare workers have contracted and died of COVID? Is due to the CDC changing standards and telling practitioners to reuse disposable PPE or lack of using proper donning and doffing techniques?
You know, I'm not sure I agree with that. If you look at some of the data potentially out of China, actually, the healthcare workers, for example, in China had extremely low infection rates. So I think that obviously, if you look at the data here in the United States, in general, healthcare workers have done a reasonable job at donning and doffing PPE. The guidelines, obviously we were in a bind with the medical supply chain early on that has lifted where we have more N95 masks and are reusing less. So I actually think our healthcare workers have done a very good job. In the beginning, there were a host of what we call super shedders. And the super shedders, when they were being intubated, if somebody was unfortunately not wearing the PPE or wearing it incorrectly, was at significant risk. But as David said, I don't see that's going to be less and less of an issue as more and more people wear masks.
I think there will be a vaccine by December, by the way, that comes from the top. I think John and I are both know some of the people who are involved in actual science at BioNTech and Moderna, Pfizer. We're going to have a vaccine by the end of the year. There's a question here about the most the case you particularly remember. I tell you right now, I remember my failures way more than I remember my successes. And I just had a terrible complication recently that I'll never forget. Before that, it was a young woman that was brought in by EMS with a thalamic abscess who was breastfeeding. She had mastitis and she had a mass in her thalamus. There was an infection. And she was had a newborn. She had a mild weakness on the right side. Her dad was a physician. She had graduated Stanford, beautiful woman, brilliant. Her husband worked for Goldman Sachs in real estate. And a thalamic abscess is right next to the ventricle. We brought her to the OR to put a needle in it and drain it. And she woke up fine. I got all the hugs and kisses from the family, went home, was having dinner with my wife, and she basically went and died. That she developed a rapidly evolving meningitis after draining it. And I think that these experiences are what, you know, define us. There's nothing I could have done differently. I would have done the same thing all over again. And I think that ultimately our failures are what make us great. That they make us better the next time. That if you're good at everything and you never screw up, then you can't learn. And I think that, you know, the first person I talked to after my most recent complication, which again, nothing I really could have done about was John. And our department allows you to fail because no one's here. Schadenfreude and jealousy are the same emotion. In our department, there's no jealousy and there's no Schadenfreude. If somebody does poorly, we aren't happy about it and feel better about ourselves. And if somebody does well, we support them and congratulate them. And I think that's the team, that's what we have here, that's our ethic. And that's why we can allow ourselves to fail because we know we're all doing the right thing. And so I'm sure there was a neurosurgeon that said every neurosurgeon has the gravestones of their patients, you know, in their minds. And John in particular, I mean, I could never do what John does. I mean, I'm sure, you know, his passion with his patients who on average live a few years, he's a glioblastoma surgeon. I never could do this. In fact, John will sometimes send me patients to do a catheter treatment on, and they come to me and they're like, you know, they're so motivated, and I can't talk to them the way John does because, you know, John is this uber optimist, and I get in trouble because I say shit I shouldn't say, but that's what makes him so great because he finds the positiveness and finds the kind of way to make things right, and that's what makes us a special team, and we feed off that. So, you know, I think that's why failure and having someone like him in some ways, it's in this weird way, it's a good thing. And we only make ourselves better because of it.
Fantastic. I think that is a wonderful note to end on. Thank you all for being here tonight, for your fantastic questions and your commentary. Again, we will get contact information out, and I will work with your EMS leadership to make sure that we can keep you looped in on the patient progression. But thank you to Dr. Langer, Dr. Boockvar, Dr. Berkowitz, Ryan, Bernard, everyone who participated tonight. So we hope you all have a wonderful evening, and thank you for being here.